Testing, can you hear me? Oh, I think it's gonna be live soon. Okay, I guess that means I'm live. I'm still trying to understand YouTube's streaming dealy. It doesn't make a lot of sense to me. But let me think about this. I have gotten a lot of help with several people, like on Twitter. I asked around, no, that's something else. On Twitter, I asked around about how to stream from Reaper, my DAW, into OBS, which was kind of a weird process, to be honest. But I was able to get help from a couple of fantastic people. So let me go ahead and go to my notifications so I can give a shout out to them. Let's see, Tara C. Music. So definitely check out Tara C. Music. She does vocal and violin kind of covers. She was helping me out with this. And then as well, I got help from Drascon here. Guitar and a keyboard, and go ahead and check him out. Even though his name has like this Greek letter in it, it's Draskon. Let me just go to his channel very quickly so you can see Tara C. Music. Did I still have Tara C. Music's channel up? Let me just go here. It should be youtube.com/Tara C. Music. Now, of course, since I'm streaming, all my internet stuff is going to be slow. But yeah, Tara C. Music here. Definitely check her out. And then Drascon is Drascon5665. I guess he couldn't just get Drascon by itself, so that doesn't matter. It's check these people out. They're very helpful. I couldn't have done the stream with the effects from my DAW like I have them. So you hear the kind of reverb because that's going through my DAW. And I have backing tracks here. This piece, which will probably be up sometime next week, maybe, is a collaboration. And let me just go and find the person I'm collaborating with. PianoPeyCa, something like that, is a pianist who I recently found. And he reached out to me saying, you wanna do a collaboration? And I said, instead of doing just one collaboration, let's do two, so that one of them can go to your channel, and then the other one can go to my channel. And then like, you have to watch both channels and subscribe to both of us to get the full effect. I mean, there's going to be different songs, but they're both going to be thematically relevant. So he developed the arrangement for the first one, which is they're both going to be pieces from Chrono Trigger. And the one that is going to be his main piece, the one that I'm practicing today, is Memories of Green. Was one of the many overworld themes of Chrono Trigger. And then the piece that I will be arranging and that we'll be putting on my channel will be Wind Scene, which is another overworld theme. Why are we paying attention to overworld themes? It's because this month on the r/VGCovers subreddit, let me go take you there, there is a monthly video game cover contest. And this month's contest is overworld themes and fields. So we thought we might as well do two overworld themes that would be relevant to the contest, and we think that they're going to be great, and that hopefully people will enjoy them and will vote for us, but I got to practice these first, so that's what I'm doing right here. It shows that I have two people watching. I don't have any comments yet, but I didn't expect to have too many comments because, you know, whatever, but I've been seeing a lot of people using live streaming on YouTube these days, and Roberto Blake and even Nick Niman had like a 2-hour stream last night, and I mean, they both made something like, you know, $100 off of the Super Chat. I don't expect to get any money off of Super Chat, obviously, but I just wanted to try practicing live streaming since it seems to be something that YouTube wants to promote. Okay, so how this is going to work is I'm going to have like I did on my first live stream, the way that the music is written There's lots of other instruments at the beginning, and then it comes in for, you know, my little piece here. And the only thing that I'm kind of worried about is the fact that there are three flats in the key signature, and then there's some of these little accidentals here, and some weird stuff here. So I'm gonna see if I can play it right, and I'm gonna try to record it as well to see if it'll be right. But if it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn, I have four measures of silence that I usually use for the click source here, but since the click is not going through, I was able to get Draskon to explain how to make that not go through. You won't hear that. And then additionally, I have a backing track and all of the parts playing in MIDI with MuseScore, but since that is not coming through OBS, I've muted this desktop audio source. You should only hear these parts and, of course, the recording a sax piece, because that is what I have a monitor on. I hope that everything is in time, but I'm gonna tell you something. I'm gonna say that I cheat. I always go afterwards and rearrange and replay parts to make sure that they're perfectly in time, or I'll, you know, kind of cut things up. I think that's very important for musicians to do. It's very important that whenever you are recording something, that it's in alignment with the beat. If you decide that you want to go against the beat, then that's fine, but make sure that you're in line with everything else. I know that I've seen some stuff from other people where, you know, it just doesn't sound as great if you're not aligned with the other parts. It just sounds very unprofessional. So you want to make sure you can do that. And with a lot of these DAWs, it will let you cut things up. It'll let you stretch things. It'll let you, you know, do things. Or you can just keep on playing and try to get your rhythm, sense of rhythm better. My sense of rhythm is not great, so I will probably be editing and reshooting a lot of these. This is just for practice. So here is Memories of Green from Chrono Trigger. Okay, so that was the first track for that, the sax one. And I'm pretty sure that that's not perfect, so I'll have to record that a few times. But man, I just really like how PianoPeyCa, I'm gonna have to ask how to pronounce that, did those little flares and the piano parts. I mean, sometimes I write piano parts, but I do not know what I'm doing with piano. And it's easier, I guess, for a pianist to kind of play it than to try to write it out and try to do that. So that's good that that's there. Now, if you watch my channel that much, then you'll probably be aware that whenever I do a piece, I usually like to do something a little different. So I'll either add another part, or I'll like a chord or a harmony or something like that. So here's what I've done here. I've added a little harmony part here. And this is probably where I'm going to have more troubles here, because I have the accidental, the E-flat goes natural several times. And then, let's see, that's a B-flat still. C, A gets made natural. And then, of course, I always like to put a really high note. So here's F, the high F, which is the highest note that an alto sax can play without going into the altissimo range. Some saxes have a F-sharp key. Mine doesn't. It's just a student sax, so I don't have that. And I know some people who are really good at altissimo, and I am not at that level yet. It's not very consistent, so I try to keep my stuff at that high F or below if possible. So we're going to see if I can pull this off, but I'm probably going to make more mistakes on this part than I was making before. I see that I now have three people watching, which is really exciting. So I'm going to now turn it to track two, and then make sure that this is record monitoring is on, and turn off record monitoring three. So you see, when I put it on for both of those, you should have heard for a split second that it was kind of doubled, because the way that this works is the plugin that I'm using, Vox and Go, requires the monitoring to be on so that it monitors through Vox and Go, and then Vox and Go sends it through OBS as desktop audio. So that's just one thing that you want. Now I'm going to want to turn off this record, this armed recording, because I don't want to overwrite what I had before. And now when you hear it, you should hear, oh, I'm still getting some sort of doubling, I think. But now when you hear it, you should hear what I already have for the sax one part. So it's just playing on top of it. And of course, everything's probably not going to be aligned, so I'm going to have to line it up afterwards. But here is the second part to Memories of Green. Thank you. Okay, so with that one, there was definitely a mistake that I made there. Up here in this little part that I have here, let's see, E, C, D, E, B flat, C, A, C, F. So it should be more like. Okay, so let me, I'm actually gonna see, how does that sound in context, though? Yeah, so I don't like how that sounds, so I'm gonna go here and just go through there, and I'm going to actually, I don't think I'm gonna delete it. Yeah, I'm gonna delete it. I don't like how this sounds at all. I'm gonna start here. Oops, you might have heard me drop out a bit there because I turned off monitoring on one of my tracks. So this doesn't really work out very well if you don't have monitoring on any of your tracks. So I am back though. So I'm gonna record, and I'm gonna give me a little bit of time. I'm not gonna play with the metronome. I'm just gonna play it like right here. So hopefully I'll get the timing right. Okay, so let's see how that sounds instead if I just put that right. Issues. I think I probably should have done better tuning beforehand, but here's another place where I can cheat because there are some tools that I can use to kind of get everything in the right, right intonation and tuning afterwards. For some reason, my tuner app wasn't really working properly. I think it was because I had too many of these devices taking up all of the, mic, so it couldn't access it. So I wasn't able to do tuning like I would normally do. But I can definitely hear there's some intonation conflicts here that I do not like. Like the F is a little flat, I think. Let me just do. Okay, I had contact player because I wanted a cello. And I didn't realize that we never use contact player with a third-party, unlicensed sample. It has like a 15-minute demo, so that was kind of annoying. And I was kind of like, can I just buy contact without a gajillion instruments for like cheap? And apparently they don't do it like that. You buy it for a gajillion instruments for $300, or you buy it with 5 gajillion instruments for like $700. And I'm kind of like, this is too much stuff for me. But anyways, no, I wanted to see what I can do is with reattune here. I don't use the automatic, but what I do is I change the attack time to 50 milliseconds so I can see on a more granular level. And then what I do is I kind of just run with reattune. Thank you. I'm sorry, I just cut off the audio again because you do not hear anything unless, I think you don't hear anything unless I'm doing record monitoring. So if I turn this on, okay, I'm gonna have to figure this out because I think that record monitoring, there's something like, I can hear the reverb here because I can hear this track which goes through reverb, but I don't know if you guys can hear it whenever I turn things off like that. Okay, let me not do that. That's a different thing. Let me see if I can, because I'm trying to see, there's something like, I think I played a wrong note or something because it was clashing in these two parts. It's like, da, 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 which I don't think that's a part that I wrote, actually. Let me just see. Let me put both of these parts up at the same time, so that will make sense. Okay, so I guess it's, there's that G that comes here, and then the G comes here afterward, so they think it's kind of like the same thing, maybe? And see here, check this out. So check this out. You see here that these notes don't really align right. Okay, let me check something out. I'm getting messages. Messages here. Oh, let me turn off that. Okay. I'm getting messages. So you can see I have my grid set to 1/16. So 1/16th notes, each of those gets a line, right? And you can see that these notes should start right at the line. That's what the grid line is for. But this one starts a bit too late. This one ends a bit too late. This one starts a bit too early. So this is what I was talking about where afterwards, I'm going to either re-record or I'm just going to kind of like cut and move these around and nudge these around depending on how lazy I feel. But the worst thing about it is if these are off significantly, then it just sounds wrong. Like the parts don't go along with each other. So let me see. There are now four people watching. Yay! If anyone you want to comment so I can know who you are, feel free to do that. But Okay, I'm back, guys. Sorry, I think I have to have one of these channels set on recording to for you guys to even hear me. So definitely comment if you can't hear me, because like if I don't have this set on recording, I just noticed I wasn't hearing my echo, therefore I wasn't hearing myself. What I was trying to say is. Just this is for any musicians. If you are like looking at these waveforms, right, you can get your grid lines set to be something underneath, you know, like 1/4, because you want it to be more than just one beat per measure. Here I have 1/16th notes. And so then what I can see here is I can see, for example, that in this one, I was playing like too late. Like all of these notes, they start too late. And like I don't even need to know based off of the sheet music what note that was supposed to be, because I can guarantee you that the note should probably start at 1.5, not at, you know, 1. Whatever this is, and it ends a little bit too late. So there are a few things. If I'm consistently too late, which it seems that I'm consistently too late, then I can just kind of cut and then move everything over. But if I'm not, then I have to kind of go through on a bit by bit, you know, I have to do that. And that's something that's super critical for people to do. Like if you're a musician and you have multiple parts that you're kind of, you know, mixing together, you have to make sure that the parts are in alignment with each other. They may not have to be aligned perfectly with the beat, but they have to be aligned with each other so that it seems like a cohesive whole. That's what I wanted to say, but I don't think any of you heard it because I was totally silenced by not recording this. So there is one part I wanted to check where there seems to be clashing in the parts. So this G goes up, but it doesn't sound like it's going up, so it clashes with the G. It clashes with the G down here, and I can't solo this because my monitoring is here. Someone's going to have to tell me how I can do this the proper way. Actually, maybe what I can do is I can just
do that. Right?
Okay, so now you can hear me from my desktop, and I don't need to actually be recording.
Although I kind of still want to do that because you can hear my dog.
This is really complicated. Live streaming is complicated. I'm going to need to ask Drascon and Terracy Music how they did it again.
But anyway, you should be able to hear it even though I haven't. No, you probably can't.
I don't know. I'm going to turn this back off. Okay, so I apparently I sound too quiet at some times, but then the audio here is very loud, so I'm gonna have to figure out how to get that right. In my software, it says that my desktop audio is around here. What happens if I press play? Yeah, okay, so now I totally understand what's happening. So, the volume level in the DAW is definitely much closer to 0 dB than just my normal speaking voice. Okay, so I'm gonna have to figure out how to do that because obviously it's very important that when I'm speaking, it's at a reasonable level, but when I'm playing, that it's still at a reasonable level, whereas currently when I'm playing, it gets much closer to and also, when I go to OBS and I have my headphones on, there's like a little crackling sound. Can any of you hear that? I hope that none of you can hear that. I'll go through the live stream again when it's uploaded and see if I can hear that, but that's kind of annoying. Anyway, so, and when I move OBS away, then nothing happens. So I'm gonna have to go through and clean some of these up. Now there's one thing that, in terms of the tone, some people like a really warm sound, some people like a really bright sound, and I actually like a brighter sound, even though I am not like a jazz or poppy kind of musician. I'm more of a classical kind of player, and classical people are known for doing a more of a warm sound so that they can fit in with the rest of the orchestra, but you know, whenever they decide to allow saxes into the orchestra. But I usually like a brighter sound. So one thing that's annoying me about this is that it is kind of warm, I think. So what I can do there is, what I usually do is like, I work in the EQing. I have a, here's my EQ settings, which if you can look at this name, I stole this from INSANEINTHERAIN Music. He did a how to do recording stuff like a long time ago. And I kind of just like look at all of his notes and like try to mimic things. And he apparently doesn't like this frequency range up here. So I usually start with that as a default because this is a template, guys. This is a template that has my click source, which I didn't just say what the BPM is and what the measure is. It has my master, which I've put in this Vox and Go thing, but I mean, not everyone would have that. I have reverb, which I then change manually every time because I used to use ambience, which again is something that I stole from INSANEINTHERAIN Music, but now I like to get more of a kind of, what is the room that, oh, someone's vacuuming. Sorry, I hope you don't hear that. But what is the room that I want it to be in? So normally like a concert hall or something like that. So it's something a bit more realistic with impulse responses. And then I have alto bus with these three tracks, and I usually put in one EQ for all of them, you know, getting rid of that low range and then, you know, doing things like that. But then I usually tweak around with it because I don't like how this makes it a little bit too warm. And then, you know, the various saxes, which will have any tuning that needs to be done. It will have any saturation that needs to be done. That'll be done at a later stage, and those sorts of things will be done. And then if I have a bari sax, then the way that you get a bari sax is you record an alto sax, and then you pitch it down an octave. That's how you do it. I'm sure that everyone's like, oh, you're a faker now, but I was always a faker. And then bass, I don't have a bass yet. I think I need to write a bass part for this. The piano, the glockenspiel, all that kind of stuff, as I mentioned, PianoPeyCa, however his name is, I've already, in the earlier part of the stream, I linked to his channel, and I'll probably link to it again. He's the person who's doing all the piano, all that kind of stuff. He put it on one wave, which I said I would like to have it in multiple waves so I can do mixing on an instrument-by-instrument basis. And then this cello, it's actually from a free contact sample, Pocket Blakus. But I only learned within 15 minutes that just because it's free doesn't mean that contact will like you using it. So after 15 minutes, it like resets. So I had to make it, then get it to a reasonable state, which I don't think it's perfect, but it's at a reasonable state. And then I had to render it. I had to freeze the track. Let me see. Render freeze tracks, freeze to mono, right? So that it wouldn't time out on me. That was kind of annoying. Like, I still think that's kind of annoying. Okay, good. That's good to know. Right there. There's no crackling. I don't know how people do the live streaming, because like the live chat's on this page, but like all my other pages are like here. Like I just need to figure that out, that workflow. Anyway, so what I'm gonna do is I'm going to, since I don't like, you know, now I'm kind of warmed up, lies. I'm gonna duplicate this track. I'm gonna turn off recording on that one. I'm gonna delete this guy, and I'm gonna, can I do that? Yes, I can. I can do that. So I'm gonna re-record the first part, and then I'll have different takes that I can kind of just decide which one I like the best. Now hopefully I can figure out when I'm supposed to come in right, because I don't know if I know that. I do not know when I'm supposed to come in. So let me do it with that part, and I'll just play along with it. Thank you. read key signatures. Okay, so I can already tell that this is probably going to be a little bit too loud the way that it's being done right now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to... can I do this? I can do this. I can make the saxes that are going into the master, I can just crank that down a bit so that it's not too loud for everyone. Let me see. So I'm going to do this again. Everything doesn't line up. So here I was a little bit too, I guess, you know, late. So by moving it back, it fixed it. But here I'm a little bit too early, and then it's all over the place. So it's like I'm just gonna need to, you know, be careful. Or let me see how that plays. Should be up here, right? Like I think this first note just needs to be, you know, a full two beats instead of kind of like starting a little bit late. So let me do this. I'm gonna run it back. Okay, run it back. Okay. Thank you. is another piece that is, I really like it, Wind Scene. This one, so far, has a lot more pieces here, and, oh, dang it, and all of my parts didn't really go through right, did they? Let me try this again. Parts, delete, and then new all. Okay. And you're not going to be able to hear this because I haven't drafted the MIDIs for this. So let me just see if I can do something with OBS and turn on desktop audio. Can I do that? What if I do that? If I do this? Okay, now you do that, hear that. Yeah, okay, so the mu score to the play the piano and make it awesome. just a few new notes about that. So I'm still trying to figure out, like, when I go from mu score into OBS, there is a bit of delay, and that's something that someone mentioned. When I play with MuseScore, when I play MuseScore with OBS, there is a delay. So that's why for the first part of the stream, I tried playing from Reaper, which has ASIO. But I wasn't, don't have WinScene. No, yeah, I don't have WinScene in Reaper ready format yet. PianoPeyCa will be playing the piano for these parts. But MC Maru, let's definitely talk about doing a collaboration. Because I don't know anything about piano. About piano. If I can type right. I like how you're probably like waiting for this stuff to be posted, but you can see on my screen what I'm already gonna say, so that's like mind games. Okay, so those are the two pieces that I have for today. I'm gonna keep on working on Memories of Green, but I think I have the basic recording down. I'm gonna see if I can get the separated files for this so I can do some EQing and mixing on each part separately. But I think that this is in a good shape for WinScene here. There are a few things that I need to keep working on in this. And then of course, what's gonna happen is PianoPeyCa is going to, this is just a suggestion for piano. This is not even like the actual part. Like he's gonna like make it. It's gonna be fantastic. I'm so excited to see and hear what he pulls off from what I just kind of wrote as a suggestion. What I'm gonna do is, I think I'm gonna sign off about now. This stream has been going on for around 50 minutes, so that's like way longer than my other stream, so I'm super happy about that. I'm gonna keep on working on the boring parts of, well actually, I would say, you know, they might sound boring to you, but maybe one of these days I'll do a stream about all the stuff that it takes to get from the raw files to the final product, because I mean, you know, I'm gonna have to get all these parts aligned, I'm gonna have to play with EQ, I'm gonna have to play with the reverb, I'm gonna have to play with all sorts of effects and stuff like that. And I'm probably gonna try to add a bass part soon, just so that we have more of that low end. And the cello is good for some low end, but it's really not the bass that song needs. So I'm going to sign off. If you like this, then definitely tell all your friends to sign up for my channel. If you want to do a collaboration with me, just send me a PM or something. So let me answer some questions actually. So the violin, I have a VST called Orchestral Companion Strings in Reaper. For bass, I have a VST called Trillion Bass in Reaper. For cello, I am using Pocket Glacus with Contact Cello. For piano, in most of my covers, when I'm not doing collabs, I use Addictive Keys, but if people want to collab on any of these parts, I am totally open. Like, I'm not against collaborations, it's just, you know, I feel bad if I, like, you know, don't have, like, perfect sheet music for people. So and my sheet music, they're not great. Like, I don't pay any attention to dynamics usually. I usually start with something that someone else has done. So for example, Star Soar and Headstack, they made piano and string versions of this song, and I kind of just like mashed them together, and then I made my own piano part to go along with it. But like, I do not pay attention to dynamics. I do not pay attention to articulations unless like I really care about what the articulation is going to be. I don't put like chord markings. I don't put any of that stuff. Mostly because, one, I don't care, and two, because if I'm doing it on my own, then I'm going to go through in Reaper here, and I'm going to go through manually on any part that's MIDI, and I'm going to go through and adjust the velocity so that the dynamics are where I want it to be. One thing that I do is I put in all the slowdowns, all the tempos, so that each slowdown is directly in MIDI, so I know how to play along with it, and then I can import that into Reaper and to play along with it. I do not like leaving tempo to chance, I guess. Let me see. So, if you have any questions, I mean, I think I'm gonna sign off pretty soon. Any questions, not just about this piece specifically, but about, you know, making music in general, doing covers in general, YouTube in general, then please comment with those, because I'm pretty sure that as part of the our VG Covers Discord, which here is the Pixel Mixers Discord here, and if any of you want that, then just send me a message or write a comment whenever this goes official. But there's a lot of stuff that the entire video game cover community is doing that's really cool, and like there's a lot of collaborations and contests and things like that. Like I mentioned, these two pieces are going to be for the contest, for the Pixel Mixers contest. So this month's contest is overworld themes and field themes. So not like specific stage themes, but like the overworld where you're trying to get to places on a map, that sort of thing. And so if you are interested, then definitely check out r/VGCovers, and then there's a contest thread, March 2017 Pixel Mixers Contest Overworld Themes, made by myself. I am the guy who runs these things, but it's the judging is by community, so I'm not like biased or anything like that. And there's a contest form where if you have a contest theme from March that fits this, you know, you can submit to here, and whenever it's time to vote, March 28th, then, you know, there'll be different votings, and, you know, you can also get tips. Every time I do any of these kind of pieces, I always go into, so, note to self, MC Maru for violin. It will definitely have to reach out to you if I have any sort of solo style violin parts. Yeah, the thing about the orchestral companion is it's really meant to be a companion. So it's good for like getting that whole chorus of orchestra, but if you want like a feature kind of violin, it doesn't really work well for that. So I'll definitely reach out to see if we can set something up. Every time that I am looking for feedback, I go to Tips Help on this Pixel Mixer Discord. And, you know, there's been some people who've given me some great feedback. Like, Chris Mann is always usually very detailed about what you need to do. Jeroke, I don't know how to pronounce that name. He's also in Material Collective. He's a pianist. He gets very detailed, and he was like, here's how you need to run your system for a reverb. So whenever I get the reverb set up, I always go and say, hey, how does the reverb sound, that sort of thing, in terms of like things like, you know, you can get too much buildup in the low end. So you always have to be fighting that. Like if I go back to this piece just for a moment, you see how there's all this low end here that I've kind of EQing out? Well, there's going to be low end on every single track, and you generally won't need it on every single track. So if I just run EQ on, re-EQ on here on this piano part, you're probably going to see a lot of low end that we don't actually want. Let me just play that for a second. So check this out. Check this out. Like the piano is not known for frequencies that are like that low, and yet there's all that low end building out. So one of the things that I always try to do when I'm doing my EQ process is to say, like, does it make sense for this instrument to have all that low end? And if it doesn't, just cut, like, do a high pass filter and cut that out. Like, just knock it out. And then you have to do the same thing when you get to a reverb, because the reverb will try to amplify all the low end, and it'll make your mixes muddy. So that's just something. Streaming. Okay. I am learning from TubaHero 37 that if you have a microphone, which I do, hopefully people can still hear my mic. I think think I'm still hearing myself. Then they usually just type. They usually don't also type the response. So that's something that I'll have to figure out. Ah, dang it. Checking, check, testing, 1, 2, 3, 4, testing. I see that I have desktop audio, but I'm hearing from Augustin Rios that no one can hear. Can't hear any. Okay, so, okay, so the reason that my voice is echoey, slad JKF, is that I am running this through Reaper, and I have reverb in my effects channel, and so that makes my voice echoey. So I just turn that off, but because I'm not recording anymore, but that is why my voice is echoey. Yeah, sorry, everyone. So, dang it. Okay, yeah. So the volume of voice is definitely very quiet, and I don't know. So we have Insane in the Raid Music. He's like legit. He has a check mark and everything because he's verified. And he just recently, he has more subscribers than he can like put on like. You know, like he has too many digits in his subscriber count than he can put in one hand, like 100,000. Like you just can't, you could say 99999 and then you have 100, you know, whatever. So yeah, that's really big. So what I'm going to do is the next stream or in between streams, I'm going to try to figure out what I need to do to get the voice louder. But if I'm running it through Reaper, then it seems that if it's loud enough for the voice, it's going to be too loud for the sax. And if it's loud enough for sax, it's going to be too quiet for the voice. I do have in OBS, I have this mic here. But I think that if I do it that way, then you'll hear double. You'll hear the unadjusted mic, and it will be out of time with what's coming out of Reaper. I think that's how it's going to work. Let me just read through the comments to see if there are any other questions or anything like that. One thing I want to talk about now that I have a captive audience of 6 people is, let me see, what do I want to use? Someone asked, what's that software you use to edit all the tracks together? So this is my DAW DAW Reaper. This has a, it's free to download, but if you like really support the developer, it's also very inexpensive. Like, a lot of the other DAWs are very expensive. Let me see. I've been using this for a while now. I do have a license key. Let me just go to Reaper so you can see. Now, there's lots of DAWs. There's, like, and I wouldn't be able to even list them all. But, like, the reason I like Reaper is because you can download it for free. And they say it's a free, fully functional 60-day evaluation. But even after that 60 days, you can continue using it. But I went ahead and purchased it, one, because I like supporting the developer, two, because if you're not, like, you know, this big, the commercial license means that, like, you're planning on using it on multiple computers and, like, you're in, you have yearly gross revenue above $20,000 or something like that. Like, that does not fit me. So $60 for that license, if you're an individual and you're using it for personal, like, that's very affordable to me. And in comparing to a lot of the other DAWs, it's definitely, I would definitely recommend downloading and trying it out. But if you already have your own DAW, like, you don't have to switch over. Like, they all do the same thing pretty much. So let me see any other people in here. Wow, I apparently have some familiar faces in here. Okay, let's look through here. Ah, yes, my versions of this are some of the songs that got me into the sax. Insane. Oh, this is insane. Okay, whatever. Insane in the Rain is great because here's something that I'll tell you about YouTube. YouTube cares about session watch time, which means you start a video and how long do people continue watching YouTube after that. So typically you think, oh, I need to keep people watching my videos. Well, that's not true. If someone's watching my channel and they get switched over to, say, Insane in the Rain Music's channel and they binge watch all of Carlos's fantastic jazz covers all day, then the person who started that session gets the session watch time. So if you want to watch one of my videos and then in the recommended videos it says INSANEINTHERAIN, just click and listen to it and then listen to the next one and then listen to the next one. I like listen to all of his Carlos, it whenever it does one of my Pokemon Sun and Moon, it sends me to your entire like playlist of everything that you've done on your album. So it's like just I've listened to it several times just because of YouTube, pretty much. So I am totally down for people listening to INSANEINTHERAIN after listening to my stuff. Let me just go through Studio One. I've heard of Studio One. I think I got a free copy of Studio One with my Scarlet 2i2 Focus, right, whatever. But I haven't ever installed it because I already had Reaper. So if you can get Studio One, then that's also free, I think. As MC Maru had said, Notion 6 works well with a combination with it. Let's see, anything else? Okay, let me go through all of these. Let me think about this. By the way, those Chrome tabs, lol, do you have infinite RAM? Yes, I do have infinite RAM. And whenever it's slowing down and I have too many Chrome tabs, instead of closing a Chrome tab, I just buy more RAM. So no one can never stop me. Let's see. Nathan Thompson says, give me a shout out and I'll subscribe. Let me tell you about this. So this is something that Roberto Blake said on his. He doesn't really do shout outs unless he knows that. I guess I've already done a shout out since I said your name. But he said that it's really about getting content that his subscribers really want to know. So it's something like, if you have good content, then it's like, I'm going to, you know, shout out INSANEINTHERAIN because he has great content, right? Nathan Thompson, I'll check your channel out later, but like, have you ever been here? Like, do I know you? Like, how does that work? Like, I got Frank. He's already subscribed. Okay, whatever. But like, this is serious. Now we're talking about YouTube. Like, so there's a lot of people who do like sub for sub and who are like saying, I just want to, subscribe to me. And they post this on other people's videos. And it's kind of like, do you even think that's effective? Like, it's not effective because, like, everyone, when they see that, they're just like, oh, this is obviously a spammer. And so then they, like, ignore it. So it's like you want to make sure that you're, like, interested in people's content and that you're saying, like, oh, hey, great song. Like, really loved what you did at, you know, like, if you leave generic comments, then they're going to know that you're a spammer. But if you say, I really loved how you keep putting the lick in every single song that you do and I just hate that, like, then people will know that you actually paid attention to their song, that sort of thing. Augustin Rios asks, what effects do you recommend to improve the sax track? So definitely dry sax is like the saddest thing that I've ever heard. So you want to think about the reverb. But then what's important is kind of EQing to your taste. So if you like a bright sound, then you want to emphasize some of the higher frequencies. If you don't want a bright sound, you want more of a warmer sound, then you can kind of emphasize some of the, you de-emphasize some of those higher frequencies. And then just if there's some troubling spots in the frequencies, like there's a certain frequency range that just sounds very buzzy to me on a saxophone, and I just kind of have to find out where that is and then like cut it so that it doesn't sound like that. And I'm not an expert at sound, so I have to figure that out every time because I don't know. Other than that, G-snap and reattune because, you know, intonation is hard. Like you can be Carlos and like do like long tones like every day and then get it perfect. Or you can cheat and do it in post-production. No, seriously, practice your instruments. That's super important. You can, let's see, what are other effects? I definitely use some of Rhea Gate. It's a gate plugin. And what gates do is, like, if you have sound that's below a certain threshold, you can say, you know, cut out sound that's below a certain threshold. So, if it's below, like, if I'm tapping on my, on my desk, but I didn't really mean that to be in the performance, it's not going to be at a loud enough level to compete with the actual saxophone. So instead of having to go through and manually like do noise removal or anything like that, I do something like a Rhea Gate. I do compression. So I usually use Rhea Comp because let me show you some things here. Like if you look here, you can see how this is like a much larger kind of sound than here. So what a compressor will do is it'll allow you to get your waveform so that it's a much more. See, that's bad. Like, don't do that. It allow you to get your compression, your waveform, so that they're much more even. While also, like, you can customize it so that if you want some parts to be louder than the other parts, then you can just set the compressor to work like that. Saturation is also something just makes everything sound nicer. So those are the things that I would suggest doing as effects. Insane is giving me advice. You could consider a second channel that receives mic input from Reaper specifically for your voice and then use Reaper to set up a push to. Oh, yeah. I need to do that. We're going to need to talk about that, getting a push to talk with the voice and then have a separate. Because then you can use a reverse gate, which a reverse gate is like you set the dry to 100% and then you set the wet to something. So anytime it goes above a certain range, it amplifies. So for a lot of the YouTube vlog stuff that I do about all the changes that YouTube makes, I use a gate to make my voice sound louder than it actually is coming from the mic. Let's see. I use G-Snap for a while, but I always use reattune first because sometimes G-Snap will like get things wrong. Let's see. Why? So with getting right sax sounds, of course there's different strengths to different mics, but I'm not an expert in that. But the placement of this mic is so critical because and especially with saxophone, because the thing to note is saxophone sound comes from all along this horn, right? So if you're pointing directly at the bell, you're going to get a different kind of sound than if you're like pointing, you know, up here kind of in the neck range. Like you're going to get a naturally like brighter sound if you're up in this top part, and you're going to get a warmer kind of buzzier sound if you're in this low range, because this is where these low frequencies come out of. So one thing that I often find when I'm just placing this mic is I'll have the mic placed too far low for the sound that I want or too close for the sound that I want. And then I have to usually remember to either move where I am or move where the mic is so that I'm kind of pulling in this upper half here. And that's what it gets a sound that I usually like. I'm pretty sure that other people may do different things depending on what kind of taste that they have in terms of you know, how bright or how warm they want things to sound like. Recording piano, I think that it's just really tough. Like Chris Mann in the Discord for Pixel Mixers has been talking about like using multi-mic setups and like how to get it, like where to place things. And I would not be the one to know about how to record a piano. And the thing I would say though is the brilliant thing about using things digitally is that even if the recording is initially quieter, you can go in post-production and then make it louder. The thing you want to avoid is you don't want to clip, because when you clip, that's information that you've lost forever. You can't just, if you try to reduce the volume on a clipping piece, you'll see that those peaks that were clipped, they don't come back. They're just gone forever. Let's see. Aim at the G sharp key. Yeah, I could say that's a good thing. G sharp or upper stack. Yeah, I would see that. Performance is a super important part. Like, here's the thing about saxophone especially. Like, people are all like, oh, man, if I just buy a new sax, then I'll sound great. That is a lie. That is a lie, folks. Most of the sax sound comes from here. And then the next important thing is the mouthpiece and the reed, because depending on how the mouthpiece is kind of like, you know, the mechanics of that can change things, but it's really the closer to the source, your embouchure, that's really the most important part to getting the right sound. So like people are like, oh, you need to practice long tones, and like you're like, oh man, that's boring, but it's like that is so critical to getting the sound that you want. Like, and it's like you just have to do it. But I will say that changing the mouthpiece does have a pretty good impact. Like I was using some sort of classical mouthpiece, and I kind of switched to a more jazzy mouthpiece, and it made my sound noticeably brighter. But then I've kind of gone back a little bit sometimes because, you know, I like the classical sound sometimes. But your, you know, neck piece, your instrument, like that really has very little effect on the overall sound. And I agree, your mic placement has a big impact. The recording environment here, you can't see it, but I have like, I mean, I don't even think they're super effective, but I have like the little styrofoam, you know, wall things here to kind of help out with some echoes, you know, like, you know, whatever. But soundproofing is kind of important. Yeah, so let me keep on reading through these comments. You cannot polish a turd. That is correct. Now, of course, now that I've said that, my entire live stream is not advertiser friendly, and I hope that you're all happy. Let's see. What mouthpiece do I use? It's actually in the description of most of my videos. I now have a Jody Jazz. I want to say like a 6-something, like a 6A or something. Like, let me just kind of just figure out. It's one of their rubber ones, not even a metal one, though. Hold on. I'm going to have to figure this out. I, like, don't pay attention to all that kind of stuff. it's in the actual description for most of my videos. You'll see it. And if whenever I switch, I have to remember to change it to, you know, Yamaha 4C or whatever. Selmer 4C or Yamaha whatever, C-star or whatever. But normally, it's the Jody Jazz. Any other question? What I was going to talk about, so there's this guy. This is just, I've already made a video about how they're removing annotations coming May 2nd. And this is something that you also know about, because if you go like anywhere on YouTube now, it's like telling you bye-bye annotations May 2nd. But the thing that I wanted to say is normally, if I wanted to go full jazz, I would get a metal Jody Jazz, but I'm a faker. I only go rubber. Yeah. But what I was going to say is normally whenever YouTube makes these changes, it's because they've done a lot of data. They've done a lot of analytics, and they're all about chasing, you know, better data. So, for example, they're going to say, and this is consistent anyone you ask, that annotations are only good for desktop and that they don't work for mobile and that no one likes them. And the way that they argue that is to say, even on desktop, they have a very low click-through rate. Like, people just try to disable them, which is bad for YouTube. YouTube wants things that people will actually, you know, click on and click through. They will say that now 60% of watch time is coming through mobile versus desktop. For me, I do not get 60% of watch time from mobile. 70% of my watch time is still from desktop. So maybe you guys just need to start looking me up on your phones or something. I don't know. But for me, I still think that with in cards and slates and cards, they still have some things to fix with their replacements for annotations. But what I wanted to say for real, guys, is there is this new channel called Creator Insider, which is run by a guy who works at YouTube and who does his unofficial take on various YouTube changes. And he has a video on annotation changes. He has a video on using global translations, on using the YouTube Creator Studio mobile. And he claims to, like, read comments. If you have thoughts and suggestions about things that YouTube needs to be doing, then definitely comment on his channel. There's, like, one YouTube employee who's on Reddit, who I usually try to send private messages to occasionally, but otherwise, like, they don't hear a lot of stuff. Reading a few more of these comments, yeah, it's not true, like, metal isn't always brighter, but because it's, like, it's really about how the cavity of the mouthpiece is, and there's, like, websites that you can look at to see things like that, but, and that's why embouchure really is the most important part of the brightness versus the warmth, because if you can, like, you know, change the cavity of your mouth by, like, moving your tongue around or whatever people do, then you can get a brighter or a warmer sound. Carlos reveals that his dad works at Nintendo. That is why all of his covers of Pokemon songs haven't been taken down yet. That is clearly the explanation. I believe it. He can license songs that haven't been released in America because his dad works at Nintendo. It's kind of a big deal. Don't try to get him to license stuff. Keep that secret between us all. Let me see if there's any other comments. I think I'm about to close this. This looks like a successful first wink stream. The last stream that I did was stream that I did was actually like I took 10 tries and I wasn't really happy because I had that gap between the Mu score and the mic, which was Azzy, and the Mu score was not. So people are commenting saying I can play more beautiful with a it's really about the time that one is spent. Like, just giving someone a great violin is not going to make up for the years and years of practice. And I think that people get confused and think that, like, if you just buy, like, nicer stuff that you'll automatically be better. And that's just, like, a waste of time and a waste of money. I mean, it's not a waste of time if you're actually practicing, but it's a waste of money to just buy really nice equipment and not practice because you think that you'll just be amazing at it. That's why I'm still using my piece of junk student saxophone way back when that I probably should throw out or something. I don't know. So if there aren't any other questions, I mean, if there are questions, then I think I'm going to wrap up soon. Aren't there any pressing last minute? Ooh. Okay. Ninja Red asks, if you can play sax, can you automatically play other woodwinds? And that answer is no. So true story. I bought a clarinet a long time ago because I was like, clarinet is a woodwind like sax. I know how to play sax. So I know like the embouchure and I know all kind of stuff. I'm going to play a clarinet. So there's two things to note. There's multiple things to note. So the first thing is one, even though woodwinds kind of, I think that most woodwinds kind of have a standardized kind of fingering system where, I know like, for example, all the saxophones have the same fingerings. It's just that, this is the first point. Each instrument is in like a different key. So like the thing that I would call a G on my sax is a concert B flat. Like on a piano, it would be a B flat, right? And so a G, 1, 2, 3, it's going to, let me see if I can get this right. I'm not good at music theory. I'm not good at all this stuff. I want to say, no, I can't even say it like that. Like, I can't even say it like that. But like, so like on a alto sax and on a bari sax, which are both E flat instruments, you know, 1, 2, 3 is going to be a G, right? But if you do 1, 2, 3, that'll get you a note on clarinet, but I don't think it's a G. And there's a few other hiccups about clarinet. So one, it's not in the same key as a saxophone. But two, so the way that a saxophone is designed, and I don't know the acoustics, but it has an octave kind of jump. So like this octave key, it switches me like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is a, you know, like a D. And when I use this octave key, it just jumps me up to the D that's a higher octave. But as MC Maru just commented in the comments, when you do the register key in a clarinet, it's not an octave. So you have to know that when you jump up, that you're not going to get the same note that you were expecting. So and then the other thing about it is embouchure. Like saxophone apparently is like easy mode embouchure. Like you don't even have to care. Whereas clarinet, it's like you have to have your embouchure, like, you know, you have to have your embouchure just so, or else you're going to get a lot more squeaks. So I have mad props to people who can play clarinet because it's a lot harder than it looks. And saxophone is like easy mode. I know a lot of people who did clarinet to saxophone, and they just don't know how to do vibrato because clarinet apparently hates vibrato, I guess. I feel more people in clarinet should just forget what the classical world said and start doing vibrato, but they don't agree with me. And then flute, let me see. We need to get some flautists in to say how flute. First of all, the embouchure stuff that you learn in sax doesn't mean anything because you're playing across, and there's no reed. It's just you're playing across a tone hole, right? So it's like, I don't know about that. But I think the fingerings are pretty similar. Classical clarinet is not like Dixieland. I think Dixieland, no. Because classical clarinet is like, if you look at any kind of orchestral piece, they play straight. And so I'm pretty sure that even in Dixieland, you can do vibrato with clarinet. Like, I know that if you have, like, Klesmer music in clarinet, that is definitely not classical, right? Yeah, so a flute, the issue is, like, for most instruments, there's kind of a standardized key system, but saying a flute is a horizontal sax with a different way of making the sound, that different way of making a sound makes a huge difference because a saxophonist is not going to know how to do the flute stuff. Like, I've watched people do, like, how to do flutter tonguing and how to do whatever stuff. Like, you know, there are people who can do beatboxing in flute. Like, the coolest nerd guy, definitely check out his channel. He does a lot of beatboxing with flute, and he can do, like, classical and beatboxing. I can't do that. Like, who could do that? Like, who learned that? Like, that's definitely not something you can transfer from instrument to instrument. Sax to clarinet should be easier, but I would say clarinet to sax, like, when you know the official clarinet, then sax will be probably, like, easy mode for those people. But going from, like, clarinet to flute, sax to flute, flute to those other instruments, I don't think that it works quite as well. So I don't think it's true that if you learn one woodwind that you learn, you know, all of them. And then bassoon. Freaking bassoon. First of all, double reed instrument users are, like, fanatical about their double reeds because apparently they all make them themselves. Like, they make the, like, you can buy double reeds, but a lot of them make them themselves. So they're like, it's apparently an in-joke about making your own reeds or something like that. But bassoon, like I said, if I'm using a saxophone and I need to, you know, use my thumb, there's, like, one thing I do with this thumb, and that's the only thing I do, right? There's only one thing I do with thumb. With a bassoon, check out a bassoon and what you have to do with a thumb. There's, like, five. No. There's, like, even more thumb keys. I don't know how many thumb keys there are, but look up how many thumb keys there are for a bassoon. It's freaking ridiculous, and that stuff should be illegal. Tell any bassoon player that their thumb stuff should be illegal because it is not okay. Augustin Rios says, I don't know why I'm pronouncing it kind of like if it's French. I don't know if that's how you pronounce the name or not. The beatboxing with the flute is actually easier than playing normally. I did it in my second day when I couldn't hold a single note for 4 seconds. That's actually an interesting thing. There are some things that you learn when you're first starting out an instrument that, like, people, like, will smack your hand and say, that's bad. Like, if you get, like, a lot of squeaking with sax, then people will be like, oh, that's bad. That's bad. Yeah. The bassoon in German is like Fagot or faggot or something like that. It's like a bundle of sticks, which it is a bundle of sticks. So that translation is correct. But if I say that, I'm pretty sure that my stream is not going to be advertiser friendly anymore. Yeah, bassoon is the official term in English. So what I was going to say is on saxophone, like you get all these squeaks and you're like, oh man, the squeaks are bad. Like, let me learn how to do not squeaks. And then 5 years later, whenever you start getting into advanced saxophone stuff, when you start getting into advanced saxophone techniques about, like, what am I thinking of? Altissimo and overtones and things like that, where you're fingering for one note, but you're trying to get it to play a different note. Then all of a sudden, all of those squeaks that you did when you were a beginner that you had to beat out of yourself, those are important because what those usually represent are you're overblowing into the next overtone, or your embouchure is such that you went to the next overtone. And so, like, experts, we use those squeaks, and they have their overtones. They know how to get it to squeak to just the right note so that they could make full songs out of it. So, like, that's a very big thing in pop. There's a guy, Colin Stetson, he uses the huge, gigantic, like, I think it's a contrabass sax or something like that. And he does a few things. So one, he has circular breathing for all of his songs. Two, he has, like, this kind of, like, throat playing where he's, like, saying stuff into his sax while he's playing. And then he also has, like, overtone. So definitely check out Colin Stetson, because that's, like super high-tier stuff. Like, if you want to do a cover of Colin Stetson, you know, more props to you, but that's just never going to happen for me. I did, like, I think I've done one song where I used, I've used multiphonics. I did one song that I'd multiphonics, and that is my Dragon Quest, it was the Dragon Quest One Dragon Lord theme, because I wanted to, what did I want to do? I wanted to make the dragon roar sound. So I have an I have a combination of like an overtone kind of sort of thing, multiphonic and pitch bending to kind of get that, you know, that kind of effect. So definitely, if you haven't checked that out, like, if the song wasn't very good in other reasons, like, I didn't know anything about mixing back then, but that effect was, like, I couldn't replicate it off the top of my head, but when I was really proud that I was able to get those sounds in there. Yeah, there's, I do, Slad JKF asks, do you do lip or breath vibrato? I do the lip vibrato for sure. Breath vibrato, I don't think that breath vibrato is actually really a vibrato. Vibrato to me is a shift in the pitch. Whereas breath, so lip vibrato gets you that shift in that pitch, right? But breath vibrato, let me see if I can even do that. It's like. But that's not a shift in the pitch, right? That is just. You're like, you're just making your breath like kind of weird. And it's more like a tremolo. Well, I don't think it's like a tremolo. It's a shift in the dynamics, but not a shift in the pitch. So it's not really vibrato, in my opinion. Lip vibrato is a lot more. Yeah. MC Maru, you're on it. Breath vibrato is tremolo. It's volume. It just changes the volume when you use breath vibrato. But for a true vibrato, you want it to be changed in the pitch. I agree with MC Maru that you want your vibrato to be changed in the pitch, not the change in the volume. So we are on board. Lip vibrato for the win. Let's see. Any other questions? Let's see. Gotta get pro. See, so Slad JKF says, like, gotta get pro, but if you go to his channel and listen to, let me just go to his channel very quickly. This is a shout out. This, because I know this guy is legit, right? And so he's also like a teenager or something. So like all you teenage prodigies, like I'm gonna get in trouble with a content ID for playing copyrighted music. So like his arrangement of the Toho song, which he also does. Flute. So let me just listen to this. Can you hear this actually? Yeah, you can hear it. Let me go to the sax part. Was there a sax part? Yeah, there was. Yeah, this is pro level. This is legit. Yeah, so yeah, that's legit. That is legit. That is legit. Yeah. If you want to get a shout out, you have to be known for stuff. Like you have to like have good content, and then then you get a shout out, right? You know, he you don't just come in and say, "Oh, I bet," like he was actually participating in the stream, and like I already knew because he had entered the same contest and he's like in the same communities, that like that's legit. Like one day I'll be at that level. No, one day. One thing I would say is you don't just get started knowing how to play all those instruments that well. You have to practice at it. So like when Carlos did his jazz challenge, there's this guy who won it. Let me actually go to his channel. He did a KK slider piece, and he like played all of these different instruments, and like it makes it look really easy. But where is his channel? Oh gosh, let me just do Insane in the Rain Jazz Contest. Oh my gosh, how'd I do? Oh yeah, hold on, this guy. He's playing all of these different instruments. Who does that? Okay, so I don't want to get in trouble with copyright, but let's see. So have I done any duet videos with other YouTube? So I actually have done several collabs. Let me go to my channel, because I actually have a playlist on my channel of all the collabs that I've done. Some of them are duets, some of them are more. So I did with another pianist, Pokemon Sun and Moon Lily's theme with Team Frizen for the win, Team Frizen FTW. That was a duet. I did a like reggae sax for Hyde 209 for Golvelius, which that song in the original version is not reggae. So he like pulled some serious stuff. Fyra Fabe, it was like a big band collaboration for Treasure of the Rudras, Ruja no Hihu. That was bad. People are going to be like, wow, you lose all credibility. You can't pronounce Japanese whatsoever. Treasure of the Rudras, Evil Eyes, that was a band collab. I did a Tuba Hero 37 was in this channel, was in the stream a little bit earlier. I don't know if he's still there. But this shop theme was a collaboration that I did with him. With Kane White, I did an acoustic guitar and saxophone collaboration on Gallows in Tavern. And you could just see I've done a lot, like trombone and sax on Kingdom Hearts 2, Twilight Town, sax, jazz, sax, and guitar on KK Jazz, a two-player versus medley with Oma Broj, I cannot pronounce, Dutch, sorry, Oma, that's how I will say, and then Sharp Rain music. I've done collaborations with real clarinet players, like Soundole Music on SSN, more acoustic guitar. So yeah, definitely check out my channel. I've done a few collaborations and duets and things like that. I think of myself as a good subtoner, but there's no way I could make, yeah, those, some of these people, it's kind of like, no, I just bow down to them, like they're so much better, like whatever. Orchestral Fantasy is amazing. Let me show you Orchestral Fantasy. This is another person I will gladly give a shout out to. So this guy, Orchestral Fantasy, he does like all the, he doesn't use any MIDI. Well, I mean, I think he has MIDI because he did this thing here, but like he does all of the instruments on his own. And so see all these instruments, like he doesn't own all of them. What instruments that he like works with, like a middle ages to like Renaissance kind of group that gives him access to some of those more specialty instruments. But yeah, Orchestral Fantasy is legit. Soundole is awesome. I do in fact love that guy. Real. Yeah, no. He's legit. These are all legit people. For sure. Soundole, if you're not paying attention to Soundole, you need to be paying attention to Soundole. If you're not paying attention to Orchestral Fantasy, you should be paying attention to Orchestral Fantasy. If you're not paying attention to Slad JKF, you should be paying attention to... Is that, like, really just Slad JKF, or should I be, like, saying ADJ? Like, how do you do that? I don't know. I'm just going to say Slad JKF because that's easier to pronounce. Tuba Hero 37 for tuba, definitely check him out. Like, he was very fast. Like, I was like, I have a tuba part. There's two tuba parts. Can you get that recorded? And then, like, in a day, it was like, you know, here's the perfect parts. Like, okay, like, I guess I need to get on my sax parts because I hadn't even recorded those. So, it's just, there's such a great community and everyone's willing. Slad, JK, oh, that is how it's pronounced. I got it right. There's just such a great community. And that's why I keep on also trying to promote our VG covers here, r/VG covers on Reddit, because there's a lot of these musicians are also here. And then the Discord Pixel Mixers is here. Lots of discussion. It's very active. If you need a link, actually, can I just, if I invite people to this, am I going to get in trouble? Pixel Mixers Discord. Yeah, so the Pixel Mixers Discord, like, there's so much stuff that I've learned from Discord channels. Oh, another person that, Stephen Morris, if you're not paying attention to Stephen Morris, sound and music, Stephen Morris here, you need to be paying attention to Stephen Morris. He does modular synth stuff, but then he also plays several instruments along with that. And he's done a lot of collaborations with Soundo. But the good thing about Steven is, you know, if I ask for mixing advice, Steven Morris was like one of the first people who came in and said, hey, this is what you need to do. This is what you want to. So like half of what I know about using a DAW and I know about using music is from Steven Morris. Definitely check his stuff out. So yeah, that's what I would say. I'm trying to see if there's any other questions. It seems like we're now just having a hug box. Would it be possible that you could send me stems of the next theme you want to upload? I want to practice my... Okay, so the thing I would say about sending the stems is to get the best quality, would you want me to send you the WAV files? Because those files get really big really quickly. I can upload it and send it to you if you want, but it would, hey, the coolest nerd guy. So we've already given you a shout out, but I'll give it a shout out again. So the coolest nerd guy, first of all, he is one of these people that I keep talking about who are like super talented, but they're like teenagers. Like this guy makes these arrangements, like these multi-instrument like arrangements, and then pulls in all these musicians together, and he's like a great flautist who has a, you know, kind of the beatbox flute style. And I'm like I can't even do that. So definitely check out the coolest nerd guy. Let me just go to his channel. I'm sure he has some of his I know that some of his collaborations don't show up on his channel because they're on the Pixel Mixers channel because they're these huge collaborations. But like he did a tribute medley, and you see all these people. That's, you know, like he did the arrangement and then got all these people in on this. So the one thing I would say though is when you do all these big medleys, you can't release things as regularly as you would like to. So oops. So that's one thing I would say. So yeah. I can do a Google Drive of one of the next things that I'm gonna mix. And as soon as they said Google Drive, it turned on my phone. Okay, Google or whatever. So shame on you, phone. Yeah, so I can do Google Drive or something and then send you a link, MC Maru. Probably not to any of the Chrono Trigger things. That's kind of coming a little bit soon. But maybe in the next few weeks on the next piece that is not a collaboration. Or if I have a piece that is a violin, then I'll just send the files to you so you can have a chance at mixing. I don't mind mixing whenever I do collaborations, but collaborations are more fun when you can just play one part on a saxophone and then give everything to the other person and never have to worry about the rest of it. There's going to be like four different things that are going to be not on my channel, probably on the other people's channels. I don't even know if I can reveal it yet, but there is a community album that – actually, I can reveal it because we've already revealed it. No. It's not here because it's already been finalized. Okay, Terracy Music, Draskon, definitely still check those people out. But Pixel Mixers and r/VG covers is doing a tribute to the Rayman soundtrack. And like all of the tracks are done. They just need to be mastered. For Augustin Rios, is it that I'm recording on a low quality setting? Are the tracks supposed to be big files? If you export them to MP3, which is fine, they'll be compressed and they'll be
much smaller files. But typically when you're doing mastering work and you're trying to like send it to other people, you want to export or render to a .wav or .flac or something that is lossless. So the way I would explain it is, like, if you think about pictures, a JPEG is kind of like an MP3 where it looks good and it's a small file, but you can definitely tell that there are some artifacts from when it, you know, kind of compressed some of the data. Whereas like a PNG, I think PNG is lossless, is a much bigger file, but it's lossless. So definitely check to see if you are exporting to MP3 or if you're exporting to WAV. If I'm ever sending a stem to someone, I will send them the WAV files just so that they will have the flawless version of the file. Yeah, so many tracks. But as I said, there's going to be a lot more .ogg master race. The OGG. But the sound quality, the sound card takes care of the better quality anyway, right? Oh, so here's how it works. So it's really about storage and saving. Oh my gosh. So speaking of people that I'm collaborating with on Rayman tracks, Danilo Chaffee, I think that's how you pronounce it, Danilo CFF. Let me go to his channel so we can have a party. Danilo CFF. Did I do that right? Yeah. Danilo CFF. No, I did. Yeah. No, that's definitely wrong. That's definitely wrong. I did this the dumb way. The smart way is you can always just go to this person's channel, right? Yeah, yeah, this is the right channel. You don't even have to search for them. You can always search for them because they're in the chat. But yeah, he does a lot of orchestral kinds of stuff, right? And so we're going to have a piece for Rayman that's very classical. Oh, I got it right. Cool. No, it's Daniel Siafi. That's your new name. Danilo Chaffee. We're going to have it's an orchestra, and he did all the orchestra pieces, and I just did the saxes. And, but then I mixed it, and I had to like figure out how to place things in an orchestra and like how to like make the echo and the reverb. That would have been a fun video to watch because you can see the process of how to take a bunch of tracks and like make them fit in space. But in, when the Rayman album from Pixel Mixers comes out, and that's going to be released, you'll be able to find it on pixel-mixers.com. I'm going to take you there for a second. This is our group blog for the Pixel Mixer site. So currently our most recent album is Final Fantasy I The Legacy, which I did my collaboration with Tuba Hero 37, the shop theme. But whenever we release the Rayman, and anytime we're doing a contest, the contest results kind of go here with a link to various stuff. Most upvoted covers goes there. And whenever we release a new album, that's going to go there as well. Let me go here. I'm going to try to do these streams whenever I'm practicing. So each Saturday or Sunday, whenever I'm doing the recording for the pieces that will go up either the following Sunday or, you know, Monday or something like that, I'll try to do these streams. I would additionally like to do more streams in terms of, like, earlier in the stream, there were questions about kind of like YouTube in general. There were questions about music in general. I would like to do more streams like that. I would like to do streams on the Pixel Mixers channel. And I would like to do some sort of like kind of whenever we do the voice channel in r/Pixel Mixers and have a debate over like what is a battle theme. I would like that to be televised if we can do that. So, yes, these streams are going to be happening. I think they're going to be happening frequently, at least once a week, I think. So, speaking of all the file types, that was a big debate in the Pixel Mixers Discord because apparently not everyone likes RAR files for compression. Apparently some people don't like those and they would rather if we zipped everything instead of using RAR files. But I just don't think that's gonna. I don't think that's gonna happen. And we have MP3s that are RAR. But all I'm doing is scales. I could do
live stream on skills. I could do a live stream on skills, but then everyone would hate me, so I wouldn't. Yeah, at some point we're going to have to do Pixel Mixer stream. It'd just be about figuring out what's the best time. And I think we'll be doing multiple so that we can like get people who are online now, and then we'll do like another stream for people who are online like in the other parts of the world, and that'll be good. Full disclosure, if you are just now joining or you don't really know what this Pixel Mixer stuff is, I linked in the chat the link to the Pixel Mixer's Discord, so feel free to sign up. I think we might have already had people. Yes, we have more people join. Yes. Thanks for joining. At some point, they're going to give you a color, and that will let you see some of the other channels. And you can also like say .iam, all one word, and then your instrument, and it will give you the instrument. There's not every instrument, but definitely check out the announcements pinned message to see the self-assignable role. So you can give yourself keys, guitar, bass, brass, woodwind, strings, drum, or other. So that's something that you could do. Let's see if I have any more things. Oh, man. Octatonic scales. So, yes, the coolest nerd guy, you should have a stream where you talk about octatonic scales. I'm going to, as soon as I get off the stream, Google to see what that is, since I don't know anything about music theory. I was like, pentatonic? Now that's octatonic. I know that octa means like eight, and penta means five. And that a tonic is a drink in Chrono Trigger, which is what this stream was about. But other than that, I don't know anything about music theory. I've tried doing a like self-learn. I think I need to take like a class or something, because it's all Greek to me. So you've got the woodwind roll. Welcome to Pixel Mixers. So there's definitely lots of the one thing I would say, because we've been having this discussion, don't go to Pixel Mixer's Discord just to share your covers. Go to it to do a lot of these other things and be a part of the conversations, and then share additionally. I'm actually going to talk to you about this. Self-promotion. It's like everyone's like mystified. Like, how do you promote your stuff without, you know, people hating you? And it's, you have to show people that you care about the community first, and that you're a member of the community first, before they will care about your content. So that's true about YouTube. If you're coming into a stream and you're like, oh man, I'm going to just say, hey, Alex Bale. Okay, Alex Bale, this guy is a filmographer, and I wanted to actually put him in my annotations video, but I forgot to do it, because YouTube is getting rid of annotations after May 2nd, but the problem is that cards and end screens aren't a good replacement for annotations. And Alex Bale, if you watch his stuff, he does, let me go to his channel. Dang, I did it again. You can go straight to, oh yes, Carlos has a Discord. But yeah, you can go, oh, I can put people in timeout. No, I'm gonna go to channel. And I don't even have to search for his name, right? So the thing about this is he has a series, and I'm not going to spoil things for you, because you need to just watch the series. What he does is he does promos for his school, but his school has something going on behind the scenes, and you just have to watch the promos to find out. Now, what he does, though, is there are annotations that are, like, there's little Easter eggs and things that are hidden in some of his videos that, if you're paying attention, you'll see an annotation that will go to a certain place. Annotations works really well, because he can put his annotation at a specific spot on the video, and then if you're like paying attention, you click on it, and then you go to, you know, a secret video. This is like, when it goes away, like it really does suck, because it's like, how are you gonna do this? Like, Alex, I would definitely recommend going to, there's a guy who works for YouTube who's like Creator Insider, this guy's channel. Find him up. He's trying to get feedback on stuff. He's a YouTube employer, but he like does his own take. So he doesn't speak for everyone in YouTube, and I don't know how much power he has, but he wanted feedback on all of these different things. So go to this video and tell him that like, this is your use for annotations, and cards do not cut it.
I don't think that, I don't know if they'll be able to make a replacement, but they need to understand that this is what we're using things for. I'm actually going to close a few of these tabs, even though I normally don't like to close any tabs. Okay, you can get back here. Yes, there's no end screens with, there's no secrets with end screens. They know exactly what it's going to be. They see the thumbnail. I mean, unless you make a fake thumbnail or something, then it's like kind of a secret or whatever. Thanks, Oritsuru, for saying hi. Sorry, I haven't been practicing actually for the past hour. But when this goes up, you'll be able to hear a sneak preview of the two songs that I'm collaborating with PianoPeyCa for. One is Memories of Green. That's the one that I've been recording for. And the other one that I kind of arranged, but I don't have it ready in Reaper, is Wind Scene from Chrono Trigger. These should be coming up. They won't be coming up tomorrow or anything, but they should be coming up probably next week. Yeah. Let me see. Yes, Carlos has a Discord, but you'll have to ask him for the key to it. I think it's mainly for his Patreon people, but like, I'm not a patron, but I'm still in the Discord. Yeah, so it's like you can still get in if you don't. You have to ask him about it. So let me see. Let me read through some of these. Scales, octatonic, a scale that goes half whole instead of whole, whole, half. See that? Someone was telling me about the difference between major and minor, about which scale parts get the minor, whatever. And I was like, you know, like dumb. So half whole versus whole, whole, half. I'm like, I know what that should mean, but I don't know what that means. Like, I know what, like, oh, D goes to E, that's whole. And then E goes to F sharp, which is not half, but whatever. So, yeah. Or whole, half, since it's a continuum, whatever. So, that's all I know. Let's see. Yeah. With Reddit, I wanted to say I got my stuff promoted on the Reddit of saxophonists asking for opinions. So with Reddit is really tricky, and I haven't figured it out. And I want to find someone who's like a Reddit expert, because I know that there's a science to Reddit. I know, for example, that Reddit, it really matters how quickly you get upvotes, because things decay based off of how many upvotes. So, for example, things will stay at the top of the pile, and then after an hour, it'll start to decay, and then after a day, it'll start to decay. But when you have a certain threshold of upvotes, it keeps it up at the top longer. So, like, after an hour, if you have, like, 10 upvotes or something like that, then it will decay slower, so your stuff will stay at the top. So, like, there's a way of knowing, like, if you see something at the top of the Reddit that was submitted within X amount of time and has X amount of upvotes, then you know that you can never hit that top spot because that thing is too popular to be knocked out. So I wanted to talk to someone who's a Reddit expert and who feels like they understand Reddit very well, but I haven't been able to find that. The one thing I would say is Reddit has most subreddits have a 90-10 rule, which means you should be posting 90% other stuff versus 10% of your stuff. Most people don't do that. If you look at their Reddit submissions, it'll be like, my stuff, my stuff, my stuff, my stuff, all the way down. But technically, you're supposed to be like a contributing member who only occasionally puts your stuff. Some subreddits don't really care about this. Other subreddits care a lot. And, you know, just to make a rant about Reddit, if you share someone else's, like, photo or, you know, someone else's painting that you didn't even do and you're like, I found this painting on, you know, Tumblr or whatever, you get, like, 1,000 upvotes. But if you carefully arrange and record your own, you know, cover of a song, oh, that's self-promotion, like dying of fire. Like, I don't understand that. So that's Reddit. MuseScore. Yes, I do all of my stuff in MuseScore. I know that there is non-open source, non-free versions of instrument notation software, but MuseScore is really good for getting a free sheet music. Do you know when they're removing annotations officially? It is May 2nd, and they aren't removing them from the old videos. It's just you will not be able to edit any of the existing ones, and you will not be able to use them in any new videos after May 2nd. Yeah, so, I mean, I sent YouTube so much feedback about the notification bell, how they keep on continuing to, like, mess that up. And they're just like, nope, we're not going to change that. You don't really need to comment from the notification bell. If you have TubeBuddy, I've already made a video about this. The promo series might be over by then. Yeah, you probably should graduate sometime. But it's just It's just so sad that they are getting rid of annotations. I'm waiting for the conclusion of the promo first. Everyone check this out. You don't even go to his high school, but just check it out. Like, I really like the photography club video. That was really creative. That is, he's going to be some, I'm going to be like, I knew Alex Bale back when he was with, and now he's like making movies. It's going to happen. 5-10 years. It's going to happen. What was I going to say? I want to talk to someone on Reddit who would say that they're good at Reddit and who has a lot of karma, and they got this karma not from just reposting other people's photos. Although I think that that's probably the solution. I think that Reddit likes images more than videos and music, because an image, you can look at it on your phone and you don't need headphones or anything like that. You can look at it any time, and you can even see on the thumbnail. A lot of Reddit apps are really good at showing you, you know, a preview of the image so they can quickly upvote. Whereas with the video or with a music video or something like that, they have to dedicate a minute or 2 minutes or 3 minutes or however many minutes of their life. And so it's a little bit harder to just get popular. And then even for the videos, the Reddit subreddits that are about videos, like r/videos, that is just too, like, you have to be really a really big deal to make it on like r/videos. And probably someone else is going to post your video, not you, and get karma for that. Yeah, pictures are much, I really do think that it's pictures, images, that's really how you can build up that presence and then occasionally share a song or something. So I was actually telling this to Toxodintrail. Let me look up Toxodintrail, because Toxodintrail is doing something that is, I think, quite innovative. Toxodintrail does animated covers. So now he has animated cover. So what he does is he's an artist and he's a musician. And he does the art that goes along with the cover. Like, let me look up the one that I really like is his one on WarioWare, because he did all these different mini game skits from his thing. Let me just go to here, like in the middle, like so I don't get like copyright infringement or whatever. So like, he has like, oh, you didn't win the game, like, oh, you did win the game, that sort of thing. And it's like he has the DS, like you're playing it on an actual DS. So I just wanted to mention that Platina Jazz. I don't know Platina Jazz. Platina Jazz. I don't know that. But what I was going to say about Toxodintrail is I think that he would actually get a lot of success if he posted on Reddit his images, just the artwork that he does. And then like maybe in a comment, he said, or like he posted a gallery of the images that he did, right? And then in a comment, he said, these images are featured in my animated cover of this. Like, boom. He would get all those upvotes from people just clicking on the images. And then a few of those people would click through to the video and find it that he's doing really great stuff. So I don't draw. I mean, I draw really poorly. But, and people are like, oh, you should draw your poor, your bad counting comics and maybe one day, but he draws well. And so I think that he needs to capitalize that, because I do think that Reddit is about the photos, pictures, images, that sort of thing. We are now approaching around 2 hours of stream, and you know, I haven't been practicing for most of those. So I'm of course still willing to answer questions. I'm always willing to answer questions. A big band from Switzerland. They make anime jazz. They're big in Japan and have released 5 albums. Their arrangements are probably the best I've seen. I'm going to have to check out Platina. Wait, you know, I think someone was actually talking about this, because someone was like saying, like showing me a jazz cover of like an anime song. And I don't think I paid attention to it, but it might have been them. I'm going to have to check that out later to see if that was the group, because I was like, oh, anime jazz. Like, well, okay, maybe I'll check that out later. Big band, like that sort of thing. Yeah. So I'm going to have to see, because someone was linking me to that, and I didn't click on it because I was like, I don't have my headphones or anything like that. So I wasn't in, oh, but it may be just coincidence. Anime standards, yeah. Okay. I'll have to check that out. Let's see. What I was going to say is, yeah, I'm always open to, you know, answering any questions. So when this goes live, I don't think that the live chat gets saved. I think that the video goes up without any comments. And so the comments are like completely fresh. So I know that Roberto Blake has been experimenting with having the live chat on the video screen. And actually, you can see that since for most of this chat, my face is covering it up. Dang it. Yeah, my face was covering up most of the live chat. But he would have it where it's like his face is here and the live chat is like somewhere over here. Sorry, guys. Whenever this video goes up, people are probably just going to be very confused about what I was responding to since the live chat isn't really fully visible. We now have 7 people watching this stream. That's like a brand new record. The reason I wanted to get into live streaming and just figuring out how to do that is subception. Yeah, looking at OBS in here is really trippy. Like you just get. Like I did this, and then in RVG covers, they turned it into a meme. Where did I post it? So you can see a chain of fingers pointing to forehead, and now you can see a chain of fingers pointing to forehead in a chain of. What is this? Like what is this? Like this is ridiculous. So I'm gonna close that out. What was I going to say? Okay, so what I was going to say is, this is just a YouTube thing, right? So YouTube is really encouraging certain things. So they're encouraging very regular uploads. So a lot of musicians, well, a lot of like the great musicians like Carlos and them are like releasing one video a week. So like he gets 5 minutes, around 5 to 6 minutes of video a week. And that generates a lot of watch time each week. And really, it's about generating watch time, however you can do that. But with this, YouTube promotes these live streams. So a lot of you probably, I mean, maybe a lot of you got a message notifying you that this live stream was going on, hopefully. But it promotes those live streams. And then even when the live stream is archived, then that becomes another video that gets published and people can watch that. I don't expect people to watch all 2 hours of this, but if they watch any amount of time of this, then what happens is that's more watch time that accumulates. Oh, you got a notification. So yeah, YouTube is really big on promoting the live stream. So you get notifications you can click in, and that's really good. And then YouTube is, this continues to generate watch time. Your channel gets noticed in the algorithm if you can generate watch time and you have a positive trend of watch time. So like more watch time this month than you did last month than you did last month, that sort of thing. So I want to release more videos, but it's really, oh, you didn't. I don't think that it releases the announcement to everyone. And there are actually some settings that define what announcements that you get. So for example, if you go into this gear and you go, or you go into this bell and then you go into this gear, then it's going to say, there's going to be a checkbox for occasionally notify me of new videos and activities from my subscribers. This, if you have this checked, it will only occasionally notify you of new videos and activities, such as live videos from your subscribers. You'll always get notifications when you've rung the bell for a channel. So if I go to my, you know, manage subscriptions, then for the ones that you've rung the bell to, you will always get a notification whenever they upload a video or whenever they do a live stream. If you have a lot of subscriptions, like I do have like 345, you probably don't want to ring the bell on all of these because then you'll get way too many of these. So I just kind of, each time I do one of these videos, I just randomly pick a person and then ring a bell for them. So I definitely want all of Alex Bale's stuff immediately. I always check my subscriptions tab anyway, so I always get to see those the day that they're out anyway. But I definitely want Alex Bale as soon as possible. Let me see. I don't want that Carlos guy. I don't want him. Let's see. Danilo. I definitely want that as soon as possible. So it's like when you click to send all notifications, then you will get notifications whenever they do anything live stream or anything like that. Hey, Ricardo. Thanks for joining. Everyone who's joining right now. Like I've been doing this live stream for 2 hours, and for like 1 hour of it, I haven't even been playing. I've been just talking about the chat and all that kind of stuff, which no problem. I have no problem with that. But like, you know, that's the sort of thing. So what I wanted to say, like, I'm just giving like YouTube advice. Like, if you're a YouTube creator, then I think it's important to know how YouTube thinks about these things. They do care about watch time. They do care about new stuff. So live is new for them. They want more people using live, so they promote it more. That's why they do these. They do Super Chat. Super Chat is like their way of competing with Twitch. So like, you can give people money in Twitch. Like, well, you can now give people money on Super Chat. And like, all these big YouTubers like Roberto Blake and, you know, Nick Niman starting to get big, all these people who give advice on YouTube, they have now been getting doing this live stream, and they get like $100 off of a single chat, a single video over the course of like an hour or 2 hours. They get like $100. Like, I definitely don't expect to get $100 off any videos. So Super Chat gets anything like that. Let's see. I think I will start playing again, because I wanted to show everyone that I do have a new setup, and I'm going to turn the reverb back on so you can see that I kind of have the reverb back on. And I'm going to go back through and play Memories of Green. This is one that's going to come out soon. There's like multiple parts. There's like a piano, celesta, violins, glockenspiel, violins, two saxes, and a cello. And, you know, PianoPeyCa, who was in this chat earlier, is doing all the other parts. I just get to do like a couple of sax parts. And there's a big deal where, like, if you're on your phone, you can't send people money, which is like, why would they set that up? Like, YouTube's gonna get that figured out. You don't have to give me money unless you really want to. I haven't gotten any money on Super Chat at all, so it doesn't really matter. But it's just one of those things where in the future, like, it's gonna be their way of competing. And especially with things like Twitch and maybe a little bit of Patreon a bit, except for it's on a per video, and it's like, instead of being automatically debited out of your account, you get to decide. And when you do a Super Chat, your message goes up to the top for a period of time. So it's like, if you're like wanting to ask a question or something, I mean, I'm trying to read through all these questions, but if like I don't notice, then the Super Chat like lets you know. So I'm gonna, since there are people who've been coming in, I'm gonna play the sax. Of course, I have my mic going through reverb, and it's like muted, it doesn't act right. So let me turn record on here so you can hear that. And then I turn record off there, and then I can mute that. And there's going to be some notes of silence, because I do have kind of a lead in. And then I'm going to have it, like, the piano's going to come in, like, here. So I'm going to play this again just so you can, you know, see what you missed at the beginning of the show. You'll hear the second part that I've recorded, because I already recorded it. So I'm just going to replay the first part, which is the main part. So then I think I'm going to kind of shut things down after doing this. So this is Memories of Green from Chrono Trigger. Thank you.
Okay, so let me bring this back down.
So I had two metronomes. One was from MuseScore and one was from Reaper, and they were not in time because MuseScore is delayed, freaking ASIO. And coolest nerd guy thought he was gonna play along with it, but freaking transposing instrument. That's an E sharp, E flat. So have fun with that. Augusta asked, what do you do after that to make it all work together? So as I was saying earlier, this is not the version I'm going to use because I actually made a few mistakes. But dang it, as soon as I do that, that's going to kick me off. Let me do, turn this back on. No.
Yes, I'm going to turn this mic back on.
Okay, so what I do is
turn off all the recording, so you should now not be hearing me through Reaper. Wait, let me just ask. Can you still hear me? Testing. 1, 2, 3. I should have moved it to the mic and not pulling from Reaper anymore. So you should be hearing me without any effects. So please let me know if you can still hear me or if you can't still hear me. Because, okay. So, so what I do is, I'm not going to keep that version. I'm going to keep in this version because it's the one that, you know. What I normally do is, I'm going to listen to both of these at the same time, and I'm going to try to experiment with panning. So I put these at 40% left, 40% right, so that I can tell that they're different. And so I'm actually going – actually, I am going to try to have it so you can hear it. So I should now have reverb back on because I don't have reverb, but you can hear me through reverb. So I would normally check to see whether parts are aligned. So you can tell right here from the waveforms, I put in my grid lines for 1/16th.
You can tell right off the bat that my playing is not in line.
This should start unbeat one, this actually starts somewhere else. So what I would usually do is, it ends a little after. So I'm going to make sure that everything lines. Either I'm going to record parts until it gets right, or I'm going to start cutting things up, and moving them over.
There's even one trick that's really super cheating. There's this thing called stretch markers, and you can stretch things and shrink things and do things like that.
I don't like stretch markers too much because it makes the sound get kind of weird. So I don't do that all the time. But I'm just going to listen to this, hear it all play together. And what I do is I have a mock-up reverb.
This is not the official reverb on my voice.
This is not the official reverb that I'm using. But it's a mock-up of a reverb, just so that I can get a good feel of how dry sax sounds.
Carlos did a series of videos on mixing and doing stuff with sax, and I was just like, copy all of his settings and then do it. But then over time I realized, oh no, I need to change things up a little bit. So what I do now is I will usually have reverb. Which comes with reverb, and then on the reverb channel I'll make sure that dry is at zero.
And I'll usually put wet around 18, but this is not super important. And what I'll do is it's an impulse response. So you get impulse response is based off of what you want things to sound like. So you see I have all these halls that I can pick from.
And then I have studios I can pick from, and music rooms, and waiting rooms, and all these kind of things.
And I just kind of play around with the halls I want, making sure that it's not too echoey.
So one thing I liked, I think it was Vienna Hall I liked.
And what I'll normally...
Oh, no.
Turn that off. Okay, so... keep reverb off. And then what, and then I'll, what normally I'll normally do is I'll put a filter and I'll put a trim gain stretch. So what I need to do with reverb here, if I'm not careful, it will put in too much low range. Right?
So I want to put on a high pass filter so that anything below 350 doesn't get reverb, right? And then here, what I want to do is, I'll note that this reverb is about the tail is about 3.92. So that means everything that plays through it is going to play for around 4 seconds. That's a little bit long, so I'm going to kind of reduce that to, say, like 2 seconds. And then what I'm going to do is reduce the gain again. And I haven't figured out what's the difference between using the wet setting versus using the gain setting. I just play around with that.
And if I want the reverb to be a little less immediate, then I can use this pre-silence.
Which will make it so the reverb doesn't apply immediately. So if I turn on reverb, hold on, guys.
Versus if I have it at like 40. So that just makes the reverb take a little bit more time before it kicks in. One thing that I'll always be doing is on the Altibus, I'm going to have re-EQ to get rid of problematic frequencies. And you can see here's another one where I don't use the same EQ as Carlos because I did not buy all the FAB filter tools. I only bought Saturn
and then stole the settings for that.
But for re-EQ, I kind of looked at it and was like, what frequencies and what is he trying to go for? And he doesn't like high frequencies, he doesn't like his sound to be that bright, so I kind of did the same thing.
But I actually do like my stuff to be bright, so I usually change that a bit, and I'll usually go through. This is something I didn't know how to do for the longest time. I didn't know how to do for the longest time was go through each frequency and check to see if it's too extreme. So you can go up here and see, like, oh look, my voice sounds weird here. So I know that here is something that's doing something weird.
So I can say, oh, I'm going to cut that off so that it's not as weird.
You know what I mean?
Or I can come down here and see that this is adding a lot of bassiness, even though I have a high pass filter. So I'm going to want to avoid that.
Or, what is this? So this here is giving me a lot of that weird echoey thing, so I don't want that. So I might cut there.
So there's just, you go through the frequency range and see which frequencies you don't like in your sound.
So afterwards, I go through the sax and say, am I hearing too much of the sax body? Am I hearing too much quackiness? What am I hearing that I don't like? What am I hearing that I do like and I want to emphasize? And then I'll play around with EQ on that.
As I mentioned before, I usually use a gate. So for example, if I decided to keep in this first part here, you will notice that here I kicked my chair away. Or I kicked my, you know, something there.
So there's this noise here. But it's much quieter than the rest of the song.
So what I can do is I can use a gate.
I can use a gate. And then what I can do is pull in, no dry signal. And then the wet will be based off of reaching past a certain threshold.
So for example, that's still a bit too loud.
And I just play around with it.
So now you don't hear that. Because it doesn't hit the threshold.
And yet, if I come through somewhere here,
you still hear it there. And that's why you hear both the parts because they're both playing at the same time. And this hit that threshold.
There's also like noise removal tool. Dang it, that's not what I wanted to do. There's also like noise removal tools that you could do.
You think that it looks easy?
This took years and years of asking people and playing around. When this goes fully public,
you can watch the entire stream. I'll have to put in timestamps because there's a lot of stuff to be covered. But there's a lot of people that I had to ask for feedback.
And like Stephen Morris, Sound and Music, he was so helpful at telling me a lot of these things. Things that I now do on a regular basis.
Jer Roque, I think that's how you pronounce his name.
Also extremely helpful on telling me the bits and pieces. Chris Mann, I did my collaboration with Marie, his wife.
Pokemon Sun and Moon, Lily's theme. So Team Frieza for the win, Chris Man from that. Really helpful in getting the nuts and bolts. The coolest nerd guy said Audacity is okay-ish if you just cut something and export it.
The one thing I would say is Audacity's noise removal is much simpler to use than Reaper's.
With Reaper, what I do is, like, let's say I don't like these noises, right? So if I go back to that part that had the noise, What I could have done instead of this rear gate, I mean turn off that rear gate for a second.
And if I turned on refer,
and then go into subtract mode,
and just so you can hear it, let me turn off the piano part.
But without anything, you hear that kind of little noise, right?
Well, if I go into refer and put in the subtract mode, it's going to build a noise profile, right?
So you see here what it did was when it played the air, it had little low notes.
And then when it heard the breathing whenever I moved, it built this noise profile.
So now the next time I do that, you can barely hear it because it's gone.
You keep on doing it for more parts it should be silent.
So what I could do is run reaffer throughout this entire part because you see there's that desk noise. So I actually want to run it through the entire part.
Now, the weakness of reaffer is that it will also cut high frequencies from everything else.
So, for example, there's definitely saxophone stuff that's in this range, and reaffer is not going to know the difference between noise and sax. So it's good at hiding that here, but when I get to here, it can make the sax sound kind of weird.
So that's why I like to use the rear gate approach rather than reaffer.
And I think that the noise removal from Audacity also has a bit of an issue where you can remove the noise here, but then in here your actual frequencies are a bit affected there.
So that's just a difference there.
Oh my gosh, I keep hitting the mic.
My Skullgirls cover from way back when.
I need to redo that one because I did not know what I was doing then.
And I went back and redid the first cover.
Why would you keep the part where you move the chair there?
You could also just delete that part, right?
I could also just say this, right? So that was the question. Why would you keep the part where you move the chair?
Well, I used to do that. I would just do this.
But then there's an issue where... Let's say you like to breathe. And the coolest nerd guy, I know this is an issue you face too because as a woodwind player, you like to breathe occasionally, right?
That's the thing that we like to do as woodwind players. And when you have breathing, they're going to be in the middle part. So I could say, okay, I'm breathing probably around here. So I could pick this and I could delete.
But then I have to go through every moment of breathing and I have to delete that.
Or what I could do is I could come in here and I could come into the volume. And this is something I used to do for a long time and I could make it fast in, and I could come here and then I could put little points there and reduce the volume selectively for when I'm breathing.
That's something I used to do for a long time.
Not having key pressing sounds.
That's something where you just need to make sure that your horn is better.
Like my horn is very gunked up.
So it's like I just have key pressing sounds.
If there's a way to make it so that there's less key pressing sounds without having to clean your horn or get a new horn,
I would love to hear that. But for me, it's because my pads are dirty.
That's why I have key pressing sounds.
But to get back to why not remove, I could do this, but again, I have to go through every time that I have a breathing sound, and I have to do this.
So it's not very automatic. But what rear gate does is it knows you see that there's nothing you can see here.
So you know that it's not going to hit the threshold.
So you can just cut it out. And make sure that your threshold picks up everything that is actually real instrument.
So that's why I use the rear gate approach now instead of using just deleting stuff.
For key presses, Skullgirls is a crazy fun album. And I definitely want to do more stuff there. And I probably actually want to...
redo the stuff that I've done in the past with everything that I've learned in the past because
like the solo that I did in that was like that's not a solo. And I don't know jazz.
So I need to have like insane in the rain music doing the sax solo.
He's gonna be big band.
And that's what he's gonna do.
I could see the idea behind keeping breathing sounds. Breathing sounds are sometimes good.
Because it makes it real.
So I can see keeping breathing sounds. But here's an issue that I haven't really figured out how to do. Another plugin that I used is Fab Filter Saturn for saturation.
And instead of using warm tape, I use Bari Saturator O.
And I'll increase the band one so there's no saturation here.
And I'll usually add some air in the upper range that'll make everything brighter.
So let me actually remove that from there. I want to do it on the actual.
I don't want to reaffer. I want re-gate. So I would put Saturn up here.
Now the issue that I haven't figured out how to fix. With Saturn is that when you use a crisp mid saturation, like very saturator O, as soon as I put it on the main track, it should now change my voice too. And it should add a lot more brightness to this upper range here. In fact, it's kind of annoying. I usually make my voice sound more bassy, but the issue is the air, the breathing, it's more Apparent, it gets picked up more with the saturation setting. So I usually like to remove the, and you can hear my fan a lot more here.
Like you can hear my fan, right?
So that's because the saturation is saturating the sound of the fan and the air moving. And so I usually need to do some sort of control on the breathing
if I'm using saturation.
In some of my songs where I distinctly want breathing, if I have a moment of silence where I want it to be like breath silence,
you know, where there's no instruments playing but it's breathing, then I'll keep them in. But a lot of the times my saturation plugin will make it a little too much to bear.
Other than that, licensing, having a licensing discussion now. If you go over five minutes on licensing, the issue is that it costs more to license by five minutes because there's a formula that's like one song or X synths per minute.
And the way that it works out is at five minutes, that's when it switches over.
So, yeah, we're having discussions on that. Oh man, I have 10 people on here now, and I'm trying to finish this.
This is like the most people I've ever had on a stream.
Because it's like the only time I've had a stream.
So if there aren't any questions, I think I'm going to wrap this up. This stream is going to go on the channel.
So that people will be able to watch it afterwards. And I'll probably find some way to do some sort of time stamping or something like that about when the major topics were concerned.
We're covered.
Double audio. Carl's like, this is still going on. Yeah, it seems like people are leaving now. We're down to six. So I think I'm going to close this out.
Thanks so much for watching.
You'll be able to hear this version, which again has very few effects, just had like a mock-up reverb. And next week, I think, is when the full version is going to be published.
And it'll probably be on PianoPeyCa's channel. Because the other song that I've been doing, Wind Scene, is going to be on my channel.
So you'll have to watch both channels to get versions. But you'll be able to hear what does the song look like after I've done all the editing.
And then you'll be able to say, wow, that sounds so much better than what was on the live stream.
But thanks so much for joining everyone.
If you have any questions or if you have any ideas for any future live stream,
I'll try to be doing this each weekend anytime I get around the chance to practice.
And of course, I enjoy answering questions.
So I think I'm going to log it off now.
See you.